Random House Audio presents Double Cross Blind by Joel N. Ross. Read for you by Holter Graham. Chapter 1. 11:46 p.m., December 1, 1941. The young woman hitched her skirt to her thighs, revealing slender legs encased in Lyle stockings.
"I do apologize, they're not silk,"
she told the man in the shiny black waistcoat.
"So terrifically hard to find silk these days, isn't it?"
She lifted her skirt a fraction higher, and as the man gaped, she brought the heavy iron piping down hard on his skull. He fell to his knees and made a funny wheeze. It was rather exciting. She hadn't been in London during the Blitz, but oh, how she'd envied them, the drama. The whine and clump of the incendiaries and ack-ack shells, the streams of tracers and the barrage balloons bumbling overhead. Now the Luftwaffe was raiding more heavily again, and she felt a glow of pleasure at being part of the grand sweep of things, a glitzy Berlin cabaret with brilliant spotlights sweeping the darkened stage, but better for the real tears and blood and love. And bomb sites were super places to trap and scrap one-time informants. The man in the shiny waistcoat was like a funny crab trying to crawl away over the rubble. She checked that the message he'd given her was intact. She knew that some people in the SD, the Sicherheitsdienst, the security service of the SS, considered her flighty. They'd laughed that her code name should be Schmetterling, butterfly. But she wasn't flighty. She was dedicated and smart, and she did what needed doing. She lifted the iron piping to finish the man, but was interrupted by the gleam of a blackout torch pricking among the wreckage and an air warden calling out,
"Hello, miss, you're within the danger area." "Oh, this poor man," she cried. "Please, he's hit, he's injured. Oh, do help."
She knelt as if to care for the man and put her knee on his throat.
"What? Is the gentleman hurt?"
The elderly air warden hurried forward, babbling questions. She felt the knobby bone of the man's throat crack and separate under her knee. She heard him wheeze and die. But it was nothing so climactic as a death rattle. She stood, her hand to her own throat in horror, her eyes wet and wide. The air warden became agitated, and she began to weep. It was curious, the lingering scent of a bomb site. Brick dust as thick as the London fog, mixed with the smell of damp plaster and heavy clay and the bitter waft of domestic gas hissing from shattered pipes. The bouquet of an eviscerated building. She even imagined that the man in the shiny waistcoat had exuded a sort of fleshy sweet fragrance, like Narcissus, as he died. She sniffled away from the air warden, murmuring that she simply had to leave, then rode her bicycle through the dark streets to slip into Mr. Pentham's house through the garden. She memorized the message the man had given her and destroyed it. Was it bad news? She couldn't decide. She was forbidden to contact Hamburg except once, the first and final time, when the mission was complete. The British had direction finders, and there was no reason to jeopardize the operation by using her wireless too soon. The agent she called Bookbinder was in place. Not the place he'd intended, but in place nonetheless. He could not fail. Her faith in him was religious. The two of them together would ensure the victory of the fatherland. It shouldn't be long now, 10 days at the outside. It was the most thrilling assignment of her career, and her satisfaction was complete, except for the occasional whiff of dead Mr. Pentham, who, she was afraid, was beginning to go off. But even that could be ignored, caught as she was in the excitement. She considered the message again. She'd never met a Yank, not really. Thomas Wall.
Perhaps she'd call him Tommy. Chapter 2. Early morning, December 1, 1941. Thomas Wall woke from what wasn't quite sleep. The bedside lamp smeared feeble light on the patterned tin ceiling and the scarred wooden bedposts. He sat up and the room reeled. He steadied himself against the mattress, his breath catching at the pain in his bandaged right hand. The broken memory of a fever dream flashed and was gone. England. He was in London. The Rowansey Royal Hospital. A hospital dormitory and asylum once packed to the rafters with shell-shocked husks of the Great War. Now, a new generation clamored at the gates as Churchill faced Hitler across the narrow channel. Tom had a bed in a semi-private alcove, and the enforced company of hollow-eyed men, stiff and brittle as scarecrows. All he needed was time, quiet, cool darkness. He needed sleep, hadn't slept for 2 days, and someone was coming. He heard footsteps on the tile floor, sounding over the snoring, wheezing inmates. Tom turned his head, and the light of the hallway blinded him, shining like a deadly beacon on a deadly night. The operation, the recovery, the airfield on Crete. He lifted his bandaged hand to shield his eyes and heard the rustle of skirts. "Harriet," he said.
"Still awake, love,"
a nurse replied, matronly and bustling. He recognized her voice.
"You and me both, Mrs. Harper. No rest for the wicked."
"The weary, Mr. Wall. No rest for the weary."
"Them either. But what would you and I know about that?"
She clucked. "How you do go on."
But he didn't go on. He stayed. He had recovered, except for his hand. But he stayed in the asylum, cutting paper dolls. All he needed was rest and sleep and Earl. He needed Earl. Earl was a walking bomb only Tom could defuse.
"It's coming on 7, Mrs. Harper was saying, "and you have a visitor this morning."
7? It's morning?
Another disorientation, the dawn obscured by the blackout curtains. Then he heard the rest of it.
"A what? I have a what?"
She clucked again.
"Hush now, you'll wake the others. You know what the governor said, Mr. Wall, steady as she goes."
She drew the alcove curtains, and a mumbling moved through the room as light seeped in.
"I told them, didn't I? No visitors. But did they listen to an old nurse who's been tending her boys since the Ain River?"
"I'm steady," Tom said. "I'm 4-0. What visitor?"
"A gentleman from the Home Guard, or so he claimed. Called past midnight, if you please. I put him off, of course. He'll be coming at 8:30, so we'll need to shave and dress, Mr. Wall."
"He claims to be from the Home Guard?"
"A Mr. Davies Frank, fire control, or so his calling card said."
"Not American, then," he said. "Not Earl."
The nurse unlocked a door and led him past the chapel and the display of flags. 4 flags were American, taken in 1814 when the Brits set fire to the White House. Some of the old pensioners liked to twit Tom about the captured flags, so he pretended to think they were veterans of the War of 1812 and was rewarded with toothless and grizzled smiles. Mrs. Harper led Tom toward the governor's wing and unlocked a final door.
"Journey's end, Mr. Wall. Shave, bathe, and dress. I'll have Mr. McGovern bring you a nibble. Is there anything else you'll be needing?"
"Scrub my back?"
She clucked in amusement and was gone. Beyond the door was a small, tidy bedroom. There was a suit laid out on the bed and a narrow panel door opening to an attached bathroom. There was a razor in the bathroom, an old-fashioned cutthroat with a handsome ivory handle. What the hell, giving an inmate a straight razor instead of a safety? He couldn't think. His mind was sluggish, exhausted as his body. He wanted sleep. He wanted Earl. He wanted Harriet. Shaving left-handed was awkward, and with a cutthroat, it was worse. There had been a girl who'd shaved him during the worst of it. He remembered that. He toweled dry and slopped a bowl full of sudsy water onto the tile floor and left the razor at the edge of the basin. He dressed. The suit was his. He'd bought it last year in Burlington Arcade before it caught a Luftwaffe bomb.
There was no wallet in the pocket, no money, nothing. An empty suit for an empty man. The door opened and McGovern entered. He was tall and bent like Ichabod Crane, with bony shoulders and a gaunt face. He was stronger than he looked, and he ruled the men with a brutal bonhomie.
"Got yourself all prettied up, then," McGovern said, putting a tray on the bedside table.
Tom ignored the tea and dry biscuit.
You look a little sailor boy at sea in your own suit.
That's right, Mac. Audience with the king.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.